So, yeah, the Queer Language Task Force is a bit odd task force, obviously, because it is not about a benchmark. It actually arose out of many companies in the graph data management industry meeting each other at LDBC meetings, talking about benchmarks, obviously. But one of the issues, one of the characteristics of our benchmarks is that typically we formulate our workloads in English text. And one of the reasons why we have to do that is because there is no common graph query language. So it would be good, I think, for this industry, this nascent industry, if there were such a common graph query language. And I think that feeling is shared by many companies, actually. And LDBC, in its mission, I mean, we are here to define benchmarks and to make products more comparable. But in general, the underlying motivation behind that is that we want to make graph data management software more mature and help, yeah, mature this industry, help it grow. And help it become more accepted as a recognized alternative, technological alternative for managing data when it has a graph shaped, and therefore having a query language, a common query language accepted by different systems and supported by different systems would be great. So it is not the mission of the LDBC, but it is very related to the mission. Yeah, okay. That said, I don't think that the LDBC has as planned to become a language standards body. But we hope that from this task force, something interesting could emerge. Okay, so the Graph Queer Language Task Force studies queer languages for graph data management systems, and specifically those systems storing so-called property graph data. Okay, so property graphs are actually the property graph data model is actually not really defined. When I say it, you probably have an idea what I mean. But I will. One of the first topics was actually to define that, and we'll get to that. Okay, so this query language should cover the needs of most important use cases for such systems. Of course, we have many use cases here from TUC meetings, and so LDBC is in a good position to think about that. And we also have our own benchmarks, so we would like to express our own benchmarks also in this query language. Benchmarks, okay. So this is the task force composition. Well, Marcelo is regrettably not here. He couldn't make it. But he is a very well-known researcher with respect to the semantics, the formal semantics of query languages and the study of the complexity of query languages. You may know his work from actually spotting a quite serious problem in the semantics of the Sparkle 1.1 original specification, which made the path expressions in Sparkle incomputable, effectively, on large data. And he wrote a paper on that, and subsequently this Sparkle definition was fixed. So we thought at LDBC that Marcelo would be a great scientist to be part of this task force, because he can make sure that we will not mess this up. So as Sparkle 1.1 regrettably experienced. There is quite a few South Americans actually in the trail of Marcelo, I would say, but they are generally very strong people in theoretical computer science. And I think that's very good to have in this particular task force. And there's obviously LDBC participation, but also academic participation, like George Fletcher is here. Yeah. So it's a very nice set of people, and I think we have worked together quite nicely. Okay, what are the goals? So, to devise a list of desired features of such a graph query language and functionalities, and also to look at the state of the art, so to evaluate Cypher, Gremlin, Sparkle, SQL in this respect, and identify possible holes, functional holes, or other undesired problems, properties of these query languages that might be improved. Okay, so the result should be a better understanding of the design space and state of the art. And the target is to achieve this within 1 year. And actually this 1 year has completed now, because this task force was started a year ago. The subsequent phase would be to develop a proposal for, or develop proposals for changes to existing languages, maybe changes to Cypher, maybe changes to SQL, or potentially even a proposal for a completely new query language. But that's actually on the program for next year. I actually went through our minutes. I was actually taken aback by the need that I had to present the progress of the task force, because I'm, somebody has to do it. So what I do, I actually look through our minutes, and you see here what has been talked about. So we started talking about what is the property graph data model. Okay, that was on the topic of the first three sessions. And so subsequently we had case studies where existing query languages were analyzed and discussed. So we looked at Sparkle, Cypher, PGQL, which is the Oracle query language in actually there is a great paper and tomorrow that will go in detail on PGQL, which is a very nice language as well. Spark, the SparkC API, which is actually not a query language but an API, and we also looked at Gremlin. There was also Renzo Angles from the University of Talca wrote a quite comprehensive survey where he covers more than 100 papers that have been written either proposing or commenting on graph query languages in some form. So there is extensive literature on this very topic. I mean, it has come in multiple waves. Even in the 80s there have been papers on graph query languages. And I remember that Alberto Mendelssohn proposed, I think, in the 80s also his own graph query language. So there is a lot of work already in this area. So that's actually a nice resource. Okay. So at the half year mark, there was also some kind of summary, and this is the second. So there were 28 of those sessions. So we shifted gears later, trying to identify examples, functionalities that would be desired for a query language. So that is the kind of the focus of the next month. And well, in the end, here in the last sessions, we have been discussing pros and cons of certain functionalities, and trying to make decisions on to see if there is common ground in the task force to say, well, this we find important, this we do not find important. So there were proposals, and these proposals were typically a bit voted against, and then decisions were made on the various issues. So what did we talk about? Graph pattern matching. Graph pattern matching, like in Sparkle, typically leads to finding matches, and finding matches leads to binding tables, where you get bindings on vertices or edges, like Sparkle does. And the different questions were discussed, but I will go into detail in the following slides. Okay, this is just to give you an overview of how we have operated. So the graph, what is a property graph? In our definition, well, it's not very surprising. A property graph, it consists of nodes, set n of nodes. It has edges, a set of e of edges. And these edges, these connect to vertices. These edges and nodes both can have labels from a set of L of labels. So we have labeled edges and nodes. And both labeled edges and vertices, and both edges and vertices can have properties. Nothing more than that. There was quite a bit of discussion on whether we should, in addition to this very basic property graph data model, also have schema. Okay, schema would mean that given maybe a label, so suppose that we have vertexes with label person, you could interpret that as these vertexes represent instances of the class person, and then you would expect such vertices to have maybe certain properties, like first name, last name. That would imply a schema. So that would, you could have potentially a property graph model enriched with schema. But well, there was a lot of discussion, and there are of course many users, we think, that actually, and we have seen this in the LDBC TUC meetings, that actually use property graph because they don't require a schema. So on the other hand, I think if you look at the data that's actually stored in graph databases, almost always there is some kind of rough schema, emerging schema, because the data is not random, and systems and query languages can benefit from schema. So maybe it should be an optional thing, but it should not be a required thing, because this would be taking away an important freedom that people experience when using these this property graphs. Sure, interrupt me.
So, you might have a question at the end.
No. So that's great.
This property model, is this the one that all the different property graph databases support, or does somebody else do something a little bit more or less than that?
I think this is most support, yes. Yeah. PGQ, Neo has this. There are some. I mean, this is still a summary, because there are some nuances. So, for instance, can a vertex have multiple properties with the same key, mm-hmm. property key, or not?
Yeah.
I think Neo4j supports that. Actually, don't know. Now I'm exposed as the non-leader of this task force. That I think we don't support that. Yeah, in this definition. Yeah. Yeah.
So there was why did you, the decision make to make sure that N and B have four disjoint sets?
That N and E are disjoint sets.
Yeah. That no node can also be an edge.
Is that actually on the slide? This decision.
That's yes. The edges line. It's E is a
fine. Oh no, elements in common. Yeah, sure. Yeah.
E have no elements in common.
Yeah, yeah. That's definitely a difference with RDF.
Yeah. So it makes a small model.
Yeah.
But there's no.
Well, I don't think that apart from RDF systems, there are no property graph implementations that actually do that. So maybe that's the answer. I must confess that I was not the driver of this discussion. But I think that's the reason. Okay, one other basic discussion that was actually raging for quite a few, it's actually still raging, is it is what types, or what sorts, maybe is better, what sorts are does the query language query on, and specifically return. So, I mean, a graph query language, you could say, would be expected to have as input graphs, and maybe as output also graphs. That is like the ultra-orthodox view to graph query languages, maybe. So graph in, graph out. Then you might be able to achieve compositionality, which is important, because then you could stack queries on top of each other. However, Sparkle is not like this, as we know, because Sparkle queries a graph but returns a table, a binding table. Yes, yeah, it really returns a binding table. Yeah. Okay. No. Right. Sparkle ask. Okay. That's what people
Sparkle
use for querying. Yeah.
Sparkle select.
Is it ask? Is it so?
Ask is returns a boolean.
Okay. Right. I'm sorry for my ignorance. Yeah, okay, well, that is what people basically, well, often use, I would say, when they do queries on Sparkle systems. Right, so... right, so... Sure. But yeah, but I see construct more as like some kind of insert of a new graph. So it's not really that you can have a Sparkle construct query and then query that.
Yeah. You can't have a construct in the subquery, for example.
No, that's true.
So I see it as kind of, because what you see happening in a construct query is effectively you create these bindings. And then these bindings are pushed into insert statements, if you wish, like constructors of triples. So it's like a table in disguise again. But, yeah, okay.
With the construct,
well, but the semantics is you create these bindings, and the semantics of actually what bindings are created are exactly the same as select, and then these are put in kind of some kind of template that generates triples, if you wish. So it's a bit of a trick to kind of to get graphs again. But in any case, so the reason why I think people use select a lot is that if you build an application, you really actually want a table very often. Because, well, there is so much stuff in people think in tables. You are kind of expecting multiple instances, and these multiple instances must have, well, hopefully some properties in common. Otherwise, you cannot make a list, or there are so many visualizations that you would want to do that actually require tabular data underneath. Okay, so people really like tables. So if you would only do graph in, graph out, then many people would ask for this feature, please let me return a table because my application wants a table. Okay. So then you get into a query language that already has two sorts. So you could return maybe a graph, but then you would return also tables, because users like tables, very often at least. And then we also have paths in graph query languages. So a path is not really the same as a graph, because you could, for instance, have paths that visit the same vertex multiple times. So not every, and then there is an order also in these paths. So then, actually, we are already discussing, because sometimes we want to return paths. We want to find paths. Then we would have to return three different sorts of data. Okay? Okay, paths, graphs, and tables. Is this desirable? Yes, no. That is a big discussion. This is still an open issue. There has been a proposal to restrict ourselves only to tables. But this is not seen as the only solution in the task force.
One proposal is if table result sets, but with the column types allowing for graphs as.
That's also so. Thanks, Shasan. You can also kind of try to push graphs and paths as if they were a literal type. This is also a possibility, but it also has drawbacks in that, you know, if you put something in a literal and that something might be enormously large, okay, you kind of might be misusing the query language. And can you then, inside that literal, do subqueries? And how will systems be able to cope with that? Because there is a huge difference between like having a million tiny graphs and handling that well, you need certain algorithms for that, or having one row with a huge graph in that single row. So it is also dangerous from the systems implementation point of view, because you would have to support these two extremes and everything in between in a system, because users would have the freedom to do all these things. Okay, one of the things that was discussed about was shortest paths. the functionality of a shortest path. Okay, what would be desirable? This is a discussion not only from the feature side, but also thinking about what the system's consequences of a particular feature would be. Our group has this nice composition that we have both systems people and theory people. Okay, so I think we got to the agreement that we would like to have shortest paths, definitely, but we also would like to guarantee good performance on these shortest paths. And shortest path algorithms can be efficient as long as they fall in the class of, if they are weighted, weighted shortest paths. We have simple shortest paths, obviously. Weighted shortest paths, also very desired. But these are only supportable efficiently if the weight function is a monotone sum. Okay, then you can use Dijkstra kind of algorithms to prune the search space. And that is a restriction that we will likely impose. The shortest paths through a graph should not only search the whole graph, but it would be very desirable that you can put constraints on which vertices and which edges can be traversed. Because very often this is the case in user scenarios. User scenarios are quite rich, but would say, okay, so, I mean, I'm interested in specific shortest paths, okay? Not in the general shortest path, because of some because of the data needed you in particular have. Again, this has, you can say yes, we want to allow this, and yes, we want to allow this, but it could also have consequences for the complexity of these algorithms. These Dijkstra algorithms for finding shortest paths, they cannot really deal easily with generic Boolean constraints on the path, specifically if the constraints would compare, let's say, the current path lengths, or something that depends on the path being constructed is very hard to support. The generic case. There are subcases where, I won't go into that, that could be supported, but there is lots of theory results. There is a pretty good understanding of what is supportable efficiently and what is not supportable efficiently, and we would like to restrict ourselves to what is supportable efficiently. So certainly, examples of what's supportable efficiently is if the Boolean constraint on the vertex properties only touches on the local vertex properties and doesn't include a subquery or a condition or a value computed by a subquery. These would interfere with the search algorithm. But if that's not the case, if there is no search interference, then you could, in a very simple implementation, even first compute a subgraph, only letting survive the vertices that survive the filter and letting survive the edges that survive the filter, and then you're back at a normal situation where you could use these algorithms. But actually you can support a bit more, but in any case we will also restrict ourselves to constraints that allow still efficient implementation. A further interesting piece or question in shortest paths is, we are generally not only interested in the shortest path between one source and one destination vertex, but these source and destination vertexes in a query language could be computed by, a subquery. Okay? And then you're not only talking about the possibility of single shortest path or all pair shortest paths, even where you have a set of vertices that's both the in and the out set, but we're talking about the general case of bulk shortest paths, where I mean that you have a set of input vertexes and for every input vertex a set of possible destination vertices. Okay, with a query language you can easily construct these set combinations, and then you ask, between this source and these destinations, what is the shortest path? Okay. That most generic case we want to support. Okay. And what do we want to return? Well, obviously for weighted shortest paths, we would like to be able to return the weight. So does there exist a shortest path? That's reachability. what is the length or what is the weight, the total weight of this, the cost of this total, of this path. But we also want the path itself sometimes. Okay? Yeah, I want to return the path. The final discussion in this area is top n shortest path. So do we only want to have the best, the shortest path? Or do we want to have multiple shortest paths, top n shortest paths? Here there is some discussion, okay? Obviously you can support these things, but there are people who say that in the scenarios that we see often, top n shortest path would lead or could lead to meaningless results. You know, you can, because if you have a large data set with potentially obviously very large amounts of possible paths, then the top n shortest paths are typically very minor variations of getting from A to B. Okay? You could even get into an extreme situation that you might have like a small cycle, a cycle with a low wave, and then you will get the shortest path with taking once this small cycle, taking two times this small cycle, taking three times this small cycle. Also think of like a problem like finding your way in a map. You're not really interested in all the ways, if you're zigzagging through blocks, to find all the way that you could take a left and a right turn. Very often you get into these situations. So the question is whether we are really helping users by offering top n shortest paths. Okay. And there is also the boundary case that there can be multiple paths with exactly the same cost. And if you ask for the shortest path, then you might still be forced to return multiple shortest paths if you want to return them all. Potentially, actually, very many, by the way, that could all have the same cost. So should we support that, yes or no? Maybe not. Maybe not. But then the question is, which one do you then return? Because you would like to have a deterministic query language where there is a checkable correct answer. So then you get into discussions, okay, if we would have equivalent length paths, maybe we can kind of impose some lexicographical order on those paths that would allow us to uniquely choose one, the one with the lowest lexicographical order, for instance. I would say that discussion is not fully settled either. Okay. I made one contribution. Yeah, sure. I don't understand the question. There's an implementation question, maybe.
Well, it makes a big difference for performance, because we want a telecom integration.
Absolutely.
Any
absolutely. That's an optimizer decision. The optimizer, it's also a function of your data set, so that shouldn't make its way into the language.
Yeah, no, we haven't.
I mean, let me put it this way. Typically, the way to handle this is through hints, right? So you should have a hint mechanism if you really care about it.
I would first have to explain your question to the theory people, but I think they would not like the suggestion. No. Just kidding. I think we may have discussed this even. Okay, I made one contribution, so here you can really question me on. Relational approach to graph query languages in suggesting that. So the suggestion goes as follows. So you could see a graph. Graph is a set of vertices and edges as a set of two tables. Okay, it's a table with vertices and a table of edges. Okay. So and this table V with vertices would need to have some kind of key, unique key. Let's call it V dot key, and then it could have columns which might be nullable, and these would correspond to the properties of the property graph model. And it also would have similarly a table E with edges, and this table would just contain two foreign keys from N2, okay? And they would have foreign key constraints, so they point to the key of the vertex table, and have also properties as columns. In this proposal, I suggest actually to use a non-normal form 1 data model that you also find nowadays in big data systems like Hive, okay, where you can have nested tables to support multi-valid properties, because that's something that's actually supported by definition. You can have multiple values attached to this set of values attached to a property. Well, there is some syntax that you could suggest, but for declaring this, so it's like a special kind of foreign key, but it's actually nothing more than that. But this, I argue, could be fully optional. The point is that now you would potentially not make any attempt to have a graph type. You would just represent the graphs as two tables. Okay, always, with some system support. So I call this seeing graphs in tables. And here is a suggested potential SQL extension, in this case, where you introduce a clause. This is the reaches over clause, reaches over edge. Okay, so it essentially says that you have a tuple variable v1, you have a tuple variable v2. These are introduced somewhere in subqueries in the from clause, typically. It could also be introduced in subqueries. And you're looking for paths, you're looking for reachability in this case, because we're not asking the path. And the distance, actually, of the shortest path. We're looking for that. So we're looking to see if v1 and v2 are connected with the path. In this case, we actually want to know the shortest path and want to know the weight of that shortest path, which is called score. If you would connect them by edges from some table variable E. And that table variable E could be a subquery. So you could use the normal SQL subquery mechanisms to deliver tables. You can compute tables V, you can compute tables E. You would not need any pre-declared schema. You could just take any V expression or any E sub expression. But by saying, okay, E contains edges, okay, and the keys of those edges are listed there, the system gets informed of the fact that you view that table or subquery E as a set of edges, okay? And then it will use this edge table to do Dijkstra, in effect, to look for shortest paths. So you can say, well, why would you propose this? Well, the biggest, I think, upside of this is compositionality. Because you can easily see that because SQL allows you to have subqueries in the select, in the from, and here also in the where, okay, so you can build queries on queries on queries on queries that represent graphs. And this is actually quite hard to achieve otherwise. So that is the biggest upside, I think, of it. The other reason why a SQL extension might be interesting is that, systems that already implement SQL also want to cover, presumably, the graph space, or might want to be interested in covering this graph space. And this is a neat way to integrate that functionality. So, for them, okay? I think. So, this led to a discussion. And the discussion was actually separated into six different points. Use the idea to use tables to represent vertices, edges, and paths, because that also extends to paths being represented as tables. using nested tables to represent partners. The idea of the hive-like nested representation. I don't have an example of that. It would be a bit too deep. Constructing ad sets from subqueries, that's the compositionality idea. Restricting to monotone sums, I discussed that previously, it's actually independent. Having it, the idea as such to actually consider extending relational languages. And this actually, most of them are accepted, this one was contentious. But here, this led to a basic question for the task force. Okay, so should we focus on something like this or not? And I think people recognize that coming up with maybe a proposal for better SQL support for graphs is interesting, but it should probably not be the only thing our task force should do. So likely we'll come up with two proposals, one being a native graph query language proposal, but also one being expressible purely in SQL. Although we would like to keep the expressive power of both proposals equal. Am I saying this correctly, George?
Yes.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so there was... In this proposal, by the way, we do not see... We actually see E star here, okay, as path. So you can have zero or one or more edges that you traverse to construct a path. But I think that in the task force there is broad support to support path expressions, okay? So richer path expressions than just E star. And there is a particular relatively recent paper that shows that a rich set of a rich dialect of path expressions can be supported, can be implemented using linear algorithms. Okay, and this goes back to the that if you have like a path like a star dot b star or a plus dot b star, these kinds of path expressions, you can actually reduce these path expressions to a finite state automaton, and then effectively get it into the original problem of clean star of just a star. Okay, so you can implement those kind of more complex path expressions also efficiently. What this is about, this particular proposal that was published, REM stands. What stands? It's REM stands for. Regular expressions with memory. This is about a proposal how you can have constraints on the path, because this is one of the things we want to do. We do not want to have all A's in A star, but like in X path, you could imagine that you would constrain to certain A's. In X path, you would open a square bracket, and then inside the square bracket, you would have some kind of Boolean expression that would have to be true in order for these A to be traversable. And I already thought that if these Boolean expressions are path independent, then you can actually also executing just before starting the whole path search, and the complexity is not affected. But if those Boolean expressions also refer to the path under construction, then the pruning algorithm may not be used. In this proposal, a restricted set of inter-path comparisons are allowed and are still shown to be efficiently computable. In particular, while you're traversing the path, you may mark up already from left to right. You may mark up variables, and they use this dollar syntax for this. You mark up variables and remember the variables that you have seen, and then you can in the constraints refer back to those variables and use them in a comparison. That particular set, that particular sub-language for Boolean expressions is also still efficiently computable. There was a lot of discussion about this, or this was proposed, and I think people like this because this is the most powerful known dialect that is still computable or efficiently computable. But there was contention on how this concept, how easy to understand this is for users. Okay, these queries, certainly the syntax as proposed in the paper is rather, it would scare, I think, people away from using this this feature. It would make the query language likely quite hard. So that is an issue that was discussed. So you get the most out of the expressive power, but it may not be, it makes the language harder to understand, and therefore, yeah, we want adoption for this language. So this language should not only be powerful, but it should also be easy to write and too easy to understand if you see an expression to understand what it does. Okay. Now I have to explain your proposal, Oscar. So this proposal is actually making queries, I think it's making queries easier to read. So what you have here is that you would start the query by declaring certain path, by defining certain path expressions up front. You can compare it a bit like with a with clause in SQL. With, and then you can define some kind of view. And then later in the subsequent query, you just refer to that view. Similarly, here you define with path a potentially complex path expression, and then later, and you bind that to a variable, well, ABC for instance, and then later you can just write ABC star, for instance, okay, in a path. And these kinds of path expressions. So ABC here means, well, first this is in cipher syntax. Or actually PGQL. This is a feature of PGQL, I think, as well. It says, well, first take an A edge, then a B edge, and then a C edge. That's, and then you say, okay, that defined, I call it ABC. Later, I can write ABC star or ABC plus in the where expression, for instance, where you would actually be doing the. So it's kind of a shorthand. It definitely lifts things out, and this. This leads only to computable. So they fall in the kind of the good class of path expressions, and that also includes obviously the possibility to express these constraints. By nature, these constraints, because they only these constraints here we are not actually using AB yet. We are just defining it. Later, we are using it in a clean star, so AB star. Here there is no star yet, so these constraints, by definition, therefore, do not refer to the path under construction. They just return to the properties of a particular edge, vertex. Okay, but they can actually, like in ABC, they could compare something from C with something from A. Okay, but so you get conditions between multiple edges and between multiple vertices, but not in the context of a clean star, and that keeps it computable. So that's nice, so it keeps it computable, and also by lifting this path out of the main query body, you make the main query body more readable, and therefore more understandable. So this has a good chance of actually, I think, making it in some way into our proposals. Okay, yeah, so actually I should have shown this slide before, because now I kind of explained this with lots of text, but now here you see ABC being defined, and later you're using ABC star. How am I on time, actually? Oh, yeah. I'm already over time. Okay. Yeah, you can also use, this is a proposal how you could bind So this would be just a condition, a Boolean condition that filters bindings. But for the surviving bindings, you could then bind the path to a path variable. Okay. Okay. So again, we had some discussion on the various properties and made certain decisions. I think in the interest of time, I should kind of go over this. I'm almost there. So, yeah. Constraining both edge labels and properties of vertices and edges along paths. I think because this, both edge labels and properties of vertices and edges along path is the problem here. So we want to stay away from these comparisons inside a clean star. That would make the expression incomputable. Or, well, not incomputable, but exponentially complex. But that's effectively the same for a large graph. Okay. Well, so did we achieve our year one objectives? I actually don't know. But I think we got close. So we did analyze the state of the art in queer languages, and we identified holes, and I think that, and we better understand where these are. So I think that's kind of successful. Although I do think, at least personally, as a participant in the task force, you get so engulfed in all these discussions, and these discussions go in very many directions, because we are talking about not only about expressivity of the language, but we are continuously also talking about, well, we're also trying to think about what are the consequences for the complexity and the computability of this. And we are also talking about at the same time how readable or understandable will this be. And then there is the other dimension of how does this fit into existing systems like SQL systems or maybe Cypher and Neo. So it is like multi-dimensional space that is hard to get a real grip on. So sometimes I felt really lost, and now coming back a year later and being confronted with our targets, I had to really think about, okay, did we make our target? But I think we got close. But it's not easy to structure this process. And currently we are kind of making decisions. Okay, so we want this, we want that. But I think we should not forget that we cannot really decouple all these different decisions, because they have to come together in one queer language design. So it's a holistic problem. So it's not easy. So the queer language task force will continue. There will be more discussions, more case studies, more functionality discussions, but we are now focusing more on actually working towards proposals. And this year we will definitely start writing these proposals. So that is what we will do, and likely there will be a native query language proposal and a SQL extension proposal. And that concludes my overview. Javier?
You'll have a proposal, or it looks like two proposals.
Yeah.
So how do you plan on, where do they go? How do you envision them? And it sounds like you're looking to move them into a de jure standards body, ideally. And if so, are you trying to hand over the reference implementation, a starting point for that?
I think the question is still too early. We are currently trying to come up with something that is attractive and coherent, and we are not there yet. So when we've got something like that, I think we have to cross that bridge of seeing where it should best go and how it should best be adopted. So I think we are trying not to jump to kind of conclusions, and we do want to involve people and to hear their feedback. So also people, for instance, on the SQL standards committee would be interesting when we have something concrete to show that to them and to listen to their feedback. But it's not our immediate. I mean, until we have a real proposal, we cannot really talk about what we want to do with it.
Add to that, is it, when you talk about language proposal, I see this, is this a list of requirements or functionalities with this semantic specified by but no syntax, or there's a syntax that you want to present? Or
yeah, there will be we will move into the syntax. I mean, this relational extension is most concrete in that sense. So it does propose some syntax. But this syntax is by no means, it was more of a brain dump than a real syntax proposal. But there is syntax in that proposal, but we'll work on that. And in the end, yes, we will propose syntax. Syntax and semantics.
Right, so we'll have yet another step. I mean, you've seen the XCD
concept. I think.
We need a new standard. Now we have 15 standards.
Currently both Sparkle and SQL do not support these functionalities. Actually, even SmallCypher kind of supports it, but not every. No. I'm not talking about it. I mean, I didn't say that standards. Actually, I said at the start of this talk that LDBC does itself not have any standard ambitions at this moment. No. We are investigating the design space, and then if we have a beautiful and attractive design, then we'll hand it over or talk to people who may or may not standardize this. Yeah? Yeah, it's maybe a bit political answer. Politically correct answer.
It seems to me that you're working on very useful contributions to mm-hmm. other processes that could occur. Yes,
yeah.
It's an arena of thinking. Mm-hmm. One specific question I have is, how far do you think you could go by just simply finding a way of composing graph query capability within existing SQL? In other words, trying to limit the change in SQL to allow the graph native language to be treated as almost like a subroutine or a function within SQL? As a starting point,
yeah.
It seems to me that would be very attractive.
I think, maybe also for Neo, actually, I think that you can go very far. I'm not sure. I mean, there may be some resistance to seeing graphs as tables, maybe also from users. But I think it's a very powerful concept because it does allow you to use the table like glue to make all this composition possible. Something which is not as easily achieved if you have multiple different sorts, like paths, graphs, and tables. Then you have three glues that do not always match with each other. So there are advantages to it. And you could even think of using this kind of SQL on top of property graphs. And maybe users will actually like this because then they have something to cling on to. Because then you can, because in the end they often want to reason towards a tabular result because that's what their application would like. But if you could see a property graph, you could just see it as a bit as a table because you have an idea, okay, this is a person, so this person likely has a first name and a last name. So it might actually be in some way also as an alternative, an attractive alternative, who knows? Because you could do kind of structured stuff on unstructured data. Yeah.
Existing sort of stats of native graph language, we might want to extend that, add additional capabilities, and then we've got the whole world of SQL.
Yeah.
Bring those two worlds together, minimum cost, mm-hmm. minimum touch point, and kind of some of the things that you're talking about there. So we actually extract the tabular result out of a very complex graph view of data and bring it into SQL.
Yeah. Sure.
I think this composition idea, I just want to sort of say, comment, I think it's a really positive direction.
Thanks. especially thanks to hear this from you. Yeah, we actually did discuss this. Yes, this was discussed. Yeah, there was an overview given of different object languages and constraint languages in object-oriented modeling as well. And these could be used to express quite a few use cases. Not all, but. Yeah, and that was. I mean, the reaction I think of the task force was also about the readability of those. I mean, these kind of UML kind of languages, they are very the later versions of those. They are very powerful, actually. Of those constraint languages, they are very powerful. You can do a lot with them, but they are not really query languages that you'd like to write and read, in my opinion, at least. They get rather wieldy. So I don't think, I mean, the user reception of that would probably not be so enthusiastic. And well, we do want to seduce our users to using the language. Yeah.
Environment, you have a big failure, for example, you want to rerun this path, but you don't want to find an amateur path, just the next shortcut.
Yeah, but the problem that I identified there was, actually I was arguing against it, because you find these very minor variations. What you would like to do is maybe do something like skyline paths, or something. So paths that are in some dimension really different from each other, you know? So you're not interested in the 10,000 different variants of taking the next block or the previous block left, right. You would be interested in, okay, I want to route through the city center, or I want to route that's longer, maybe over the highway. These are the options that you would like to give to users, but that is not it's really something different than the top K shortest path problem.
Yeah, I worked for the municipal consulting, and we had problem with the transportation. Mm-hmm. But you want to, there's a transportation hub. You want to move all the different trucks,
yeah,
and combine into one big truck, right?
Yeah.
But that truck has the capacity. You cannot, I mean, watch everything put there, right?
Right.
So in that case, you want a certain number of trucks moving in that hub, others move to different hub.
Yeah.
But you don't want to find all the wrong patches. You find the next short path.
Uh-huh.
That problem is very useful. It's used like a post office, uh-huh, transportation. It's a very useful feature.
Okay, but would you be able to express it just with straight top K shortest path?
Yeah, top K.
Just straight top K?
Yeah, K shouldn't be big. For example, you have a 55, this should be enough.
Okay, well, let's take that offline because I'm over time.
Okay, so
yeah.
Peter, thank you very much.